Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Here we are on February 8th, and after an interesting week for the Flames with two wins, we now find, as of this morning, the Flames are 9 points out of a playoff spot with four teams to overtake and 31 points to do it. And if you're a Flames fan and you're already thinking about the draft and free agency, I totally can't blame you. Matt, 4 points out of six this week. How are you feeling about the Flames right now?
They got some results in the games that they played. However, they didn't play particularly well in either of the last two games. So, up and down still. The Flames are continuing to lack the consistency that they've needed. And this upcoming stretch, the Flames play the next eight games. Six of them are against divisional opponents, including a visit to the Honda Center. So the Flames, if they're wanting to make the playoffs and make a good push, they need to basically sweep all of their divisional games.
And we haven't been playing well against the Pacific Division so far this year.
No, and
mind you, we haven't been playing well against most teams this year.
Yeah, well, that's one of the hurdles that the Flames will have to overcome, is not only their lack of playing well against most teams, but their shoddy record against their own division.
Well, let's take a look at the week that was for the Flames. We had three games this week, and the first one that the Flames played was against the Carolina Hurricanes. This was a game back here in Calgary against the Canes, and last time we played the Hurricanes, it seemed like the Flames didn't show up to play at all. It was a terrible game. The Flames got blown out in that one, and this one they really came back, and it almost looked like they had something to prove against the Canes. They got the 4-1 win over the Hurricanes. Last time we played them, it was a 5-2 loss on January 24th. Matt, thoughts on this game?
This was a complete 60-minute effort. And
one of the few Flames, we've seen.
Yes. I think the Flames have only had a 60-minute effort five or six times this season. So it was nice to see them coming out of the All-Star break and playing well. And they did pretty much control the game throughout. And other than that one mistake right off the after they took the lead, they didn't turn back after that.
No, I mean, we got the goal from Dougie Hamilton early. Elias Lindholm followed up with a goal. And after that, it seemed like the Flames just overtook the Hurricanes. And I think there was something to be for them to prove here, too. I think they wanted to prove to the Hurricanes they can actually play more than 20 minutes of hockey.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was a significantly better effort. And that's one of the things that the Flames have needed, is that kind of consistency. But in the subsequent games, they didn't back that up.
Yeah, it was a good effort, and I was excited after this game going into the Columbus game. I thought that, you know, riding that wave that the Flames had, they'd have a lot of success this week. And the Columbus game is weird if you take a look at it. The Flames outshot Columbus 31-18, yet still ended up losing 2-1.
And not only that, if you're a Corsi fan, the Flames had possession of the puck for 65% of the game, which usually means that you're winning that game like 5 or 6-1 or something like that. But with the possession that the Flames had in that contest, they actually surrendered more scoring chances to the Blue Jackets, which is why they ended up falling 2-1.
Yeah, this was a weird game. It was a very physical game, which I thought was working in the Flames' advantage for part of the game. I mean, we've seen them play the physical game in the past, and I thought that Columbus was getting the edge on us, but it was giving the Flames something they were used to playing. But we were giving up way too many turnovers right around the Jackets' blue line, and it wasn't letting us get the offense we needed to be getting.
True enough. And if you look at the opening goal, it was turnover in the Columbus end near the faceoff circle, and none of the Flames forwards could get back in time, and Ladislav Smead had went up and pinched and nobody covered, leaving Derek Englund to face a 3-on-1. And, yeah, ended up in the back of the net. It's those... The attention to details like that that the Flames need to, if they're wanting to push back and try to make the playoffs, they're going to need that level of consistency of thought throughout each game.
Yeah, I wouldn't say necessarily the Flames played poorly in this game. I think I would look at it that the Blue Jackets just played a better game.
To me, watching the game, it looked like a matchup of a team that was pretty much dead last and the playing a game against the team that was dead last. Neither side looked like they had anything going. There was not a lot of scoring chances throughout the game. I think the Flames only had maybe 5 or 6 scoring chances in the game in total, and Columbus only a couple more than that. It was just a very much a perimeter game, and a lot of the Flames' shots were from the outside and without traffic, and Korpisalo is a big enough goaltender where if you're not getting bodies to the net, he's just going to stop them left, right, and center.
The thing that I was noticing about this game is the Flames didn't seem to quit after 20 or 40. I thought they put on pretty much the same game all 60, and I thought they were playing well, just not well enough. Like, you know, we didn't see them, I don't know what you think, but I don't think we saw them really crash like they have in the past. But like you said, it was a perimeter game, and they just weren't able to break in and make really anything happen.
No. And credit to Columbus, their defense was stifling, and they collapsed down any time that the Flames entered the zone. Like, all their guys were in the home plate area in front of the net, and they made sure that they either had sticks in the way or cleared rebounds and just frustrated the Flames all night.
The Flames did seem to have the puck all night. They just weren't able to do a lot with it.
No. And if it wasn't for that 3-minute boneheaded period at the beginning of the third period where they allowed multiple 2-on-1s, the Flames likely come away with the 2 points. It's just the lack of attention to detail. Like, if you look at that period, Columbus didn't have a shot in the last, like, 17 minutes of the third period. And the Flames just threw everything at them, but they just couldn't find a way. And it's one of those situations where the Flames seem to be shooting themselves in the foot needlessly at times. And
how so?
Just not... with the lack of attention to detail at inopportune times. Like, in the previous weeks, they were terrible off to the start. Like, in the previous Hurricanes game that they lost 5-2, then following it up in the Dallas and Nashville games, they weren't focused and ready off the start of the game, and they got down multiple goals and couldn't find their way back. And then that extended into the Columbus game, where a couple of boneheaded mistakes ended up costing the team 2 points that, you know, if you're looking at the standings, if they had won that game, they're only a point behind Vancouver, 6 points behind Anaheim, and are poised to make a run of it. Instead, they're that much further back. They lost a game to the worst team in the league. There's only 31 games, and realistically, they're going to need to win like 22 of them.
Which isn't going to happen.
No, unless they go on a huge winning streak pronto. And
if you look at the stats up and down in this game, they didn't favor the Flames. I mean, the hits were 29-12 in favor of Columbus. We won 38 to their 33 faceoffs, but we had 20 giveaways to their 4, and they had 30 block shots to our 9. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they were blocking a ton of shots there, and not only keeping the Flames to the perimeter, but we couldn't get many actually, you know, we got a lot of shots, but not many good quality shots on Korpisalo. And I think that was a big problem.
And he's
problem.
A good enough goalie that if you're not getting the second and third opportunities on him, he'll shut the door. So It's a difficult thing, and unfortunately the Flames came out on the losing end of that one.
And then the next night, the Flames played against the Vancouver Canucks. We traveled to Vancouver to play, and this was the first back-to-back in a while where we've actually swapped goalies in the second game. Jonas Hiller got the start, and the Flames ended up winning this one 4-1, another 4-1 win over the Vancouver Canucks. Matt, what's your take on the game?
The Vancouver Canucks are an absolutely terrible hockey team, and I don't know. They really need to.
That was their fourth loss in a row.
Yeah, they really are terrible. And the only reason why they're even remotely close to a playoff spot is due to the fact that they lose a lot of games in overtime. They've already got 12 to Calgary's 3. And yeah, they're the only team that's in double digits at all in overtime losses. So if you even take half of them away, they're dead last. So, you know, not a very good hockey team. And of their players, the only player that seemed dangerous at times was Sven Berchi. And even then, not that much.
You know what, though? Berchi seems like he fits in so much better in Vancouver, though, doesn't he? He seems like a natural there. I'm glad for his sake that I think he's finally found a team that really wants him and values his talents.
Well, he's playing a lot differently than he did in Calgary as well. Like, he's engaging.
But I think the coaching staff spending more time with him there probably than they were here to really refine his game and figure out who he should be.
Well, also, you have to figure that he's on his last legs. Like, if he didn't start putting up results, he'd find himself in Europe somewhere soon. So, like, if he was engaging physically like he was in that game when he was a Flame, he would be a Flame right now. So it's one of those things that he is learning how to be an NHLer, and good on him for doing that. If he did that before this season, he'd probably still be here, but, you know, that's neither here nor there.
Sven Berchi this year has played 44 games for the Canucks. He has 9 goals and 9 assists for 18 points, and he's a minus 4. So not too bad. I mean, if you looked at, you know, his best year in Calgary was 26 games and 11 points.
Mm-hmm.
He's doing well.
Yeah. He's molding himself into the role of a second line scorer. Not going to blow you away, but not terrible.
My thoughts on this game, I thought the first period was quite a fast-paced period. There was a lot of action going on, and we had like a six-minute stretch there with no whistle, which was quite exciting to watch, and I thought the Flames were able to keep pace during that 6 minutes quite well. They didn't look like they were sucking air. They didn't look like they were tiring out. They were making the appropriate line changes and keeping the pace going, which I thought was quite unique from this team. Usually this is a team that tires easily.
Yeah. Well, not even just that stretch, but even throughout the whole period, there was only probably 7 or 8 whistles the entire period, and it seemed to go by extremely quickly. So it was good to see. Like, I know Dan Hamhuis played his first game since before Christmas in that one, and I'm sure he was having fun adjusting to the pace of it right off the bat, but.
And I think the win felt better because it was against the Canucks, too. You know, one of our arch rivals.
Yeah. Like, even if you're the worst team in the league, anytime you beat Vancouver, that's always awesome. So
taking a look at the stats for this game, the hits were in Calgary's favor, 20-14. We won 32 faceoffs to their 17. So for once, we're dominating the faceoff circle. We still had 7 giveaways to Vancouver's 4, which then has been killing us all year. And we had 19 block shots to their 14. So we need to be working on those giveaways.
I have to give special praise to one player that hasn't been having his best season, and that's Josh Juris. He dominated the faceoff circle. He won 75% of his draws, and he's looked really good as the third line center since he's drawn back into that role. So, yeah, if he can continue that caliber of play, he should be able to cement his spot in the lineup for a while at
least. I thought he looked quite good here too. And the other guy I thought looked really good is Jari Hudler, who, as we know,
he's finally coming back to playing. Like, after he missed the first handful of games in January, he's really settled down and playing like himself.
Well, and in that Monahan goal in the third period, I mean, he was digging in the corner there, and he worked hard to get that puck out to Monty.
Now, here's a question for you. The trade deadline's coming up.
Sure.
If he continues to play this way, do you try and sign him before then?
Nope.
No?
If it were me, I think his role on this team as sort of that veteran guy could be replaced, and we could get him back potentially in the summer as well. I think right now what the Flames need to do looking forward is move him for whatever asset they can get. I mean, if you look at what Glenn Cross netted us last year, I don't see why Hudler couldn't get us a couple seconds or even a first. I think that his best value right now is to be moved out of here.
Okay. I just wanted to throw that concept at you. I can agree with that. If the Flames, it really depends on what happens on July 1st, and especially at the draft. Like, if the Flames end up getting one of the big Finns, then the onus to get a first line forward is a little diminished, but
I would not be surprised if Hudler got traded away and re-signed here next year.
Neither do I. And I think that might be a good fit. Like, if he does fit well in this organization in terms of personality and chemistry-wise, so.
And unlike Glenn Cross, I think Hudler has some years left in him.
Yes.
I don't think this is his sunset moment. I don't think, like Glenn Cross, he won't get a job next year. I think there's going to be a lot of teams knocking on his door. I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't come back, but I could also see us trading him kind of with the wink, wink, nudge, nudge of, hey, we're doing this to make the team better. We'll see you on July 2nd.
Yeah, and I could see that. And I would have absolutely no problem bringing him back. You know, even at worst, having him as the good second-line winger is sort of like how Chicago has Marian Hossa. Not necessarily the same kind of player, but that same leadership and secondary scoring type guy, especially if the Flames continue to have Gaudreau and Monahan on the first line, you need somebody to play with Bennett or to ride shotgun with the first line.
Well, and we've seen that Hudler's been able to play with pretty much anyone they've put him with, which I think is great. I mean, he hasn't had a great season, but, you know, they've had him on the first line with Gaudreau and Monahan, and he's looked good. They've had him on the second line with Bennett and Backlund, and he's looked good. So I really like that he's that versatile guy who we can throw on any line, and he'll make him look better.
Yeah, and it also helps when you're running into a slump that you can just have quality guys that you can slot around. Like, for a while, you had Frolik with Bennett and Backlund, and that worked. Sometimes it hasn't, so you throw him on the third line, and it just creates options, that's all.
And Frolik is the big reason I wouldn't go out of my way to re-sign Hudler right now. I think the Flames are going to give Frolik a chance to shine there, and I think Frolik deserves that chance. So if it was me, I think that right now, with where the team is, I think Hudler's best value to us is trading him away. Yeah.
With the caveat that July 1st, if you want to come back, hey, awesome, come back. Sort of like the Tanguay and Jokinen.
Well, I would say, yeah, I would say, you know, we're at least on July 1st, give us the chance to make you an offer.
Yeah, well, just like when the Flames reassigned Tanguay and Jokinen after dealing them away.
Yeah,
same kind of situation.
You know, we might not be the best offer out there, and I wouldn't break the bank to bring him back, but at least let Treliving give you an offer. And I think sometimes guys move away from Calgary and realize how much they actually had been in Calgary, not just a hockey player, but as a community and all that. And I think sometimes you don't really appreciate it till you've left.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why, like, Jokinen and that came back, because it was a good fit for them. So we'll see. I just wanted to throw that out there as a thought. So,
talking about contracts, Winnipeg, our rivals down the road, re-signed their big defenseman. They re-signed Byfuglien today, and that was a big deal. $7.65 million for 5 years. And if you look at that compared to Calgary's big contract, which is Geo's, it's 6.75 for 6 years. I think we the more I look at that contract and the Brody contract and the Hamilton contract, the more I think that Treliving's a negotiating genius.
Yeah, same here. And like the Flames struck at the right time with Giordano, and his 6.75 for 6 years, his arm was still hurt, and it wasn't really sure if he'd ever get back to the level he was previously. It's since developed that, yes, he has, and he's only, like, I think 2 goals away from his career high. So,
and just to cut in, Hamilton is signed until 2021 at 5.7, and Brody's signed until 2019-2020 at 4.6. So, I mean, you know, if you look at it, we're paying less for all three of our top guys than Winnipeg's paying for their one guy. And I don't even think Dustin Byfuglien is anywhere near what Geo's at as far as a player.
No. And if you... The reason why Winnipeg signed him, he has that versatility. And he can slot in as a first-line right winger. You can just stand him right in front of the goalie and, you know, try moving somebody that big. So he is one of the most important players for Winnipeg, and it's good to see that they're keeping some of their talent instead of having everybody in the organization just fleeing at the first minute that they can.
Well, I think that honestly is a big reason. I think that you're going to see some of their big names, like especially Andrew Ladd, leaving in the offseason. And I think that Byfuglien's going to be now looked at as the face of the organization.
And that's important for the team moving forward. Because if they, like, especially with the season that they're having, they're just as bad as the Flames have been. They needed to have some stability. If you're terrible and then you're in Winnipeg, have fun trying to attract free agents at all. So while they do have one of the best farm systems, it takes a while for those players to actually develop and reach the NHL, so they need some talent to hold over.
Yeah, and I mean, they've got some decent talent there. I mean, you know, you got Ehlers, you've got, you know, even Lowry, Scheffele. You know, there's guys there that are pretty good players, but I think you really need that face of the franchise. And with Ladd, I think, probably on his way out, I would not be surprised if Byfuglien gets a C next year. And I think they probably had to pay a premium to get that franchise player. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, every time I see a deal like this, I go, wow, you know, we got a heck of a deal on our defenseman. And it really makes me wonder if we're going to be able to get as good a deal this summer when it comes time to renew Johnny Hockey and Sean Monahan.
Well, the good thing with those two players, at least, there are guys that are directly comparable to them in Tarasenko and Barkov. So, and Barkov, he got a 6-6 deal, and... Well, it's 5.9, whatever. And Tarasenko's was, I think, 8 years, 7.5. So I think that you can just basically point to those two contracts and say, hey, here you go. So we'll give you the same term and number and have fun.
And that's another reason I wouldn't spend a lot of time trying to re-sign Wideman right now, is I'd say, you know what, we're going to re-sign those two and we'll see what we got. Or not Wideman, sorry, Hudler. Hudler. Yeah. Is I would say we're going to sign those two guys, and whatever we got left, we'll make an offer July 1st.
Mm-hmm. Can't argue with that.
One of the big stories this week for the Flames, going back to them and moving away from Winnipeg, was the Wideman suspension, and we talked about it last week. Wideman got suspended 20 games by the NHL. He's appealing, and Wednesday, Gary Bettman is expected to announce his decision on the appeal, and... Apparently, if Bettman decides that he's going to uphold a suspension longer than 5 games, Wideman can appeal to a neutral arbitrator, which is interesting because the NHLPA has never used that tool under their current collective bargaining agreement.
And I think if Bettman does say that, like, maintains the 20 games, I think that this will be the first case where that will actually apply. The whole situation's a bit strange, especially with the whole concussion thing and the whole protocol and all of that. It's quite the mess.
I think from Gary Bettman's perspective, he has to uphold it. I think that if the league wants to hold their officials in the high regard they do, and not just in the NHL, but all over the place, we always hear about abusive officials at minor league levels and that sort of thing, they have to put their stamp in the ground. But I think this is going to be a lot longer term story than any of us thought. I think that this Wideman thing is going to really make the NHL revisit the whole suspension protocol and what's going on and what's a suspension and a head injury. And I wouldn't be surprised if Calgary's in the spotlight potentially for the wrong reason for at least the next year.
Yeah. Well, I found it interesting that Brendan Smith, defenseman with Detroit, he ended up running it into and throwing quite a solid body check on one of the referees in one of the games this week, and no suspension. And he was looking forward, very similar style of play as Wideman's, and yet nothing. So the lack of consistency between incidences like the Lucic thing where he punched the ref the same night that Wideman hit, or linesman, the same night that Wideman's incident happened, and now Brendan Smith running over a ref, there's just not any consistency. And I think the lack of consistency, I don't see how Bettman couldn't reduce the suspension down to 10 or 15 games, especially with similar plays going on that are not receiving that level of hit.
It's a good point. I do think, though, that this is going to, I think we're going to see some rules because of this next year around headshots and suspension protocols. And I think you're going to see more guys, when they get rocked, having to sit out a few shifts.
And that is, if that is the end result of this whole situation, that's a good thing. I think that the protocol where players can actually like wave off the ref or the trainers and that, saying I'm fine, that's kind of bogus. And
yeah, I think that's stupid. Like, the trainers are there to protect you, and you know, these guys are a business asset in the end to the NHL teams and to the NHL as a whole. And I think you really need to protect these guys both as people and as business assets.
Yeah, because the competitive nature, it the player is going to say I'm going to stay in the game. You have to supersede their desire to stick up for their team and pull them aside for 5-10 minutes, do your whole concussion protocol thing, and if they're good to go, send them back out. If not, you know, you're out for a week.
My guess is that we're going to see from this incident more fines imposed on teams if a player is found they're playing with a head injury.
Yes.
Right now, there's really no incentive for the team to say, okay, you know, we need this guy to sit for 3 or 4 shifts. Their incentive is really to get this guy back in the ice as soon as possible. I can see one of two things happening. I could see, not necessarily next year, but in a few years, teams being allowed to dress one extra player. So if a player is out because of a head injury, that player can step in, so there's not a void in the lineup. I can see them dressing the guy sort of as that emergency replacement. They can't just play all game, but in that scenario, so the team isn't shorthanded on the bench. But I also think we're going to see monetary fines as early as next season, that if a guy has a head injury and he's found on the ice, he, you know, the team's going to get fined a couple $1,000s.
Can't argue with you there at all. And the NHL does need to step up their protocols and all of that to make the player safety paramount, especially with all the recent findings on, you know, CTE and all that stuff. The less that you're putting the players at the risk of developing problems down the road, the better.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, the NHL is pretty good, or known for being pretty good about, you know, player safety as opposed to other major sports leagues. And I think that's something they pride themselves on. So I really think this is going to get addressed very quickly. And I think it's unfortunate that Wideman is sort of the guy to bust it all open. But I think, unfortunately, it's going to start kind of in Calgary as the epicenter for all this change.
And like we've already seen fighting pretty much go away as well. Like, I think there's only been like 7 or 8 fights for the Flames this year.
Remember last time we saw Flames fight?
Last game? Furland.
Okay. But yeah.
Before that, Bullig versus Lucic. So.
Okay.
Yeah. It's been a while. And the fighting going away is actually a good thing in that regard as well. So even if it's still allowed, but not as prevalent, like you're not just getting the McGrattans going against each other, that kind of thing.
An interesting note about Wideman: if you do the math, for every game he's suspended, he's losing $28,225.81. So over 20 game suspension, that's almost $500,000.
Yeah. And it's a good thing that he's not a repeat offender, or otherwise the amount of money he would have lost would have actually been over $1.2 million. So.
And, you know, good on the league for allowing the Flames to move him off the active roster. That move came this week. We saw that when he was moved off the active roster, the Flames made some roster moves. They brought Nakladal up from the farm team, who I think we've both said is probably the next guy due, just because they need to see what they've got there. And surprisingly, Matt, what you and I have talked about all season, Mason Raymond went on waivers, cleared waivers, and this time they finally pulled the trigger. Mason Raymond got sent to Stockton.
Yeah.
Surprised?
Well, I think that's about time, really. I think if you look at the Flames last season, we cut bait with Devin Setoguchi and after a dozen games. And Raymond...
The difference there is that was a one-year deal.
Yeah, I know. But Raymond, he's pretty much played as poorly as... pretty much as Setoguchi. And yeah, he's just not cutting it as a player for the Flames.
Well, he's been so inconsistent. Yeah. There's been games where Raymond's been just terrible. And then he's had a couple where he's actually looked pretty good. And then you'll go through periods where you don't even notice him. And then he looks terrible again, and the cycle continues.
I know. And that's the problem with Raymond, is the lack of consistency. And I know some people have said, well, why not just send Granlund down? But you have to remember that Granlund is waiver eligible next season. So you need to figure out what type of player he's going to be and whether or not you can just cut bait with him, or if he does get exposed to waivers and gets claimed, are you fine with that? And the only way...
Yeah, I also think that Granlund has nothing to gain from an AHL stint.
No, and that he's basically been one of the top players in Stockton when he was there, so... he's not going to learn anything more by dominating the AHL. He's already there. He needs to cut his teeth in the NHL.
And most, you know, third, fourth line guys don't look fantastic right away, and neither does his whole team. You know, if you think about it, he's not the only guy struggling. You know, it's not like Granlund's struggling and everybody else is, and everyone's struggling this year. So I think where Granlund's at, I would look at as par for the course.
I know, and I agree. And typically, prospects, it takes a while for them to figure out their game at the NHL level. Like we were talking about with Berchi, and he didn't know how to play that physical game and play well at both ends of the ice, and he's figured that out now in Vancouver. Granlund, similarly, he needs to figure out how to play a full complete game at both ends of the rink and generate offense as well. And that just takes time.
And we'll talk about it later in the episode, but you can tell that Flames management and coaching staff is starting to get frustrated by this team and some of the lack of effort they're putting in. So I think that sending Mason Raymond to Stockton partly becomes a move to say, look, you know, if you're not playing well, we don't want you here.
Exactly. And that's one of the things that the Flames need to figure out is who is going to be a longer-term piece, not necessarily a long-term piece, but a longer-term piece, and who you can just move away from. Because if you look at the players in Stockton, the Flames do have plenty of options available to them.
Well, and I think the obvious option right now is the guy who is named the AHL's Player of the Month for January, which is Derek Grant.
Yes, and with his two goals this week, he actually took over the scoring lead in the AHL, and he's played a lot less games than everybody else. And I do believe he has 23 goals in 29 games or 30 games, something like that. So he's pretty much ready to go in the NHL at, you know, one more move of a forward, and he's ready to go.
Yeah, I think we will see Grant up here by the end of the year.
I think by the end of the month, even.
So the stats on Mason Raymond, he's wearing number 12 in Stockton. He was 21 here, so he's flipped it around. You know, not an unfamiliar number. I think he wore 21 in Vancouver, didn't he?
I think so.
And 21 is worn by Emile Poirier. That's why he's not wearing it. But the last time Mason Raymond played an AHL game was the 2007-2008 season for the Manitoba Moose, where he played 20 games and had 17 total points. This year so far, he's played two games in Stockton. He has one assist. So he's probably more productive there than he has been in Calgary. He's a point every other game player so far.
Yeah. Well, he needs to reestablish himself, and this is a big wake-up call for him. With having one more year left on his contract, I don't know if the Flames are going to necessarily want to buy him out in the offseason. It's a possibility, although it would cost an extra $1 million for the cap for the following season.
Yeah, I can't see them wanting to buy him out. If I was the GM, I'd probably say, you know what? I mean, I think he has some potential still, but I would probably say, you know what, we're either going to bring him back and play him in the NHL next year, or, you know, he'll be our big veteran guy in the AHL. And it seems like every team has one of those guys now.
Mm-hmm. And there is a possibility that you could trade him at the deadline next year for somebody needing that extra forward, but you'd probably...
If he had a three-year deal, I'd maybe buy him out, but not with 1 year left. Yeah. It's not worth it. So, yeah, no, I think it's about time Raymond got sent down. I think it's sending a message to the entire team who has been lacking some effort so far this year. And speaking of lacking effort this year, I don't know if everyone heard about the practice today, the Calgary Flames of practice, but, you know, it's the day after the Super Bowl. A lot of guys are watching the Super Bowl. They were supposed to have a 45, 60-minute practice, and bad news even coming into the practice was Bouma and Monahan arrived late. They arrived late. Bouma got kicked off the ice 15 minutes into practice. They said he wasn't feeling well. And Harley shut the whole practice down after about 25 minutes.
Yeah, not what you'd like to see from a team that's trying to get their way back into the playoff race. I don't know exactly the particulars of what happened, but I know that the players were apparently playing so bad that Hartley just left the ice.
Well, that's it. I mean, it's common every once in a while for a player or a coach to send a message to his players and kick them off the ice. But this is the first time I've ever heard of a coach leaving the ice.
Yeah, and just walking off. And
apparently he had them all in the corner, gave him about 3 or 4 minutes of a stern talking to, and then he just skated away, and the players were just sitting there wondering what they're supposed to do now.
Yeah. Not a good situation.
Yeah, so some quotes from players today. David Jones said he wasn't happy with the way we were practicing. It's a little embarrassing when we're not making 5-foot passes. I think he was pretty pissed off about the way things were looking.
Mm-hmm. And especially with the Flames not playing particularly well in either of the last two games, and needing 22 or so wins out of the next 31 games, you have to approach it seriously and show dedication throughout, even though, you know, it was Super Bowl Sunday and all that, excuses. You just simply, you can forgive that kind of thing if you're where Chicago is in the standings or something like that. Where the Flames are and them needing every single point, that's just not acceptable at this point.
And even then, these guys are professionals. You know, I mean, I watched the Super Bowl game. I didn't think it was all that interesting of a game, but I watched it. But I knew I had to work the next day. So, you know, I watched it and enjoyed responsibly. And I think, just like anybody, these guys are professionals. They know they have to work the next day. You still enjoy responsibly.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bad precedent when we're saying, well, because they're professional athletes, you know, they can, you know, overindulge on Super Bowl day. Well, it's not like they're football players. It's not like this really means anything to them. Like, they should, just like everyone else who had to work on Monday, they need to be responsible.
I agree.
But, you know,
there's a little bit more leeway, though, is what I'm getting at. If you're not in a position where you're needing to win, that's all.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, but, you know, they're still professionals, and, you know, they have a duty, especially to the fans, to kind of uphold that, you know, I don't want to say the professional image, but not to be all hung over the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, Sean Monahan and Lance Bouma, who are roommates, were seen hustling into the Saddle Dome at 10:15 for a 10:30 a.m. practice. I don't know about the Flames, but even when I played minor hockey, if I was that close, my coach would have been furious.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that you can tell Hartley's losing his patience too, and I think this might all be related. You know, they probably sent Raymond down, kind of telling the team, look, this guy wasn't playing. He's going to be sent down. Now they're you know, sending the team home early. I will be curious to see what happens going forward, and if we start to see more guys like Nakladal or Grant be put in the lineup, because they're saying you guys just aren't playing, and these are guys that want to play.
Exactly. And I think that especially as we get closer to the deadline and players get moved out and that, I could see the Flames recalling more than a handful of players and start cycling them in, guys like Grant, Hamilton, Shore, and a whole bunch of other guys, in order to both send a message to the current group but also to the other group, saying that put up or shut up.
And I think not even, well, I think there's a couple reasons they might do it. You're right, as the deadline approaches, but I can see them calling a bunch of guys up early for two reasons. One being that after the deadline, you only get, what, 4 call-ups?
Yes.
And secondly, as the deadline approaches, you might want to sit guys who you're in the middle of making a deal on, not to get them hurt. So I could see, you know, the Flames starting to sit some of those guys out to maximize their value, especially a guy like Hudler, who's been up and down with injuries this year, and, you know, bringing a guy like Grant in to spell him off. There's no reason not to at this point.
It depends largely on how the games over the next week and a half, 2 weeks go. If the Flames say they win all the games this week and are starting to turn it around, perhaps you don't rest guys or take guys out of the lineup.
You know what, looking at this team all year, I think even if we made a run for it, if I was the GM, I'd probably still trade the guys you needed to trade. Like, you're not going that far in the playoffs. There's no way this team makes it past round one.
No, especially with Anaheim being the likeliest opponent. I don't see this team doing any better than they did a year ago.
Even if we were in the playoff spot, I'm not sure it's worth, you know, the short-term gains for the long-term sacrifice. I think, you know what, we say, all right, we're going to move Hudler, move Russell, whatever. We'll, I mean, we had a patch-together team in 04 of mostly call-ups, and we managed to go all the way. I'm not saying we will this year, but it's like, hey, if we're going to do this, this is the roster we got to do it with. Grant, Hamilton, you know, Granlund, Juris, Bolig. That's the hand that they're going to deal the team, and it'll be interesting to see how they would respond to that. But I don't know about you, I wouldn't keep Hudler just for a one-round playoff run.
Oh, no. I wouldn't keep any of the UFAs if there are actual deals out for them. or some of the other players. Like, if somebody really, really wants Ladislav Smead,
send him away.
Yeah.
And speaking of deals, I don't know, you saw it this morning, I saw it this morning. Elliot Friedman was on Fan 960, as he usually is, and they were speculating that Nashville might want a goalie, somebody to sort of push Pekka Rene a bit, because he's struggling this year. And let's be honest, Hutton's not really a challenger there. And Friedman was speculating that we could see Hiller move to Nashville, Hiller more than Ramo move out to Nashville. If that happened, Matt, what would you want in return from Nashville?
Well, anything really. If they gave us a third round pick or a fourth round pick or possibly a defensive prospect, because I do know that they have quite a number of them, why not?
It's interesting when you put things into perspective. So I agree with you, the third round pick would be a good return for Hiller, but it's interesting when you think that we got a second round pick for Red O'Bara. Hiller's arguably the better goalie, yet in the end, we'd probably end up getting less of a pick for him. It's just kind of weird to think of it that way.
Yeah, well, the difference was with Barra is that the Avalanche really wanted him, and the Flames didn't have any incentive to trade him, and they basically said, well, if we're going to move him, we want a second-round pick, otherwise we'll just keep him, and they met the price and said, fine, sure.
Yeah, no, and I get that, but it's just funny when you look at kind of the goaltenders and their career, you know, their career stats, that Barra would go for more than Hiller would.
Oh, yeah. Well, the goalie market's always bizarre. So goalies that you wouldn't think would deliver that kind of a price tag, like Robin Lehner, I would not have expected to return a first-round pick, yet he did. Other goalies go for cheap, like Eddie Lack, I think, went for a third-round pick. So, who knows?
And Nashville is pushing for a playoff spot this year, so I could see them actually, like, I think a third would be about market value for Hiller. I could see us getting a second just because they want to shore up their backup there.
Yeah. Well, it depends largely on, like, how desperate they are for a goaltender. And we'll see. I don't know. I don't think that the Flames will get a second-round pick for either goaltender. But
it's crazy things happen at the deadline, my friend.
Yeah, exactly. And especially if the Flames have more than one team that they're talking to, or if injuries happen, who knows?
If we do trade with Nashville, I can see it being a goalie-for-goalie trade, expiring contract for expiring contract, where the Flames ship, let's say, Ramo or Hiller there, and in exchange, we get Carter Hutton back.
Yeah.
Both guys are expiring contracts. They probably wouldn't want a few of them in Nashville, and we could probably use another goalie here. So I could see the Flames. I mean, we talked about Hutton being a potential target for the team in the offseason. That might give them some time to audition him.
Yeah, I could even see them targeting one of their prospects like UC Saros, or, yeah, it depends. Or
no, yeah, I definitely think that. I don't think that Hutton would in any way be a cornerstone piece there, but I could see it being like, hey, we only want to carry two goalies, so let's just swap one for one plus whatever else mm-hmm. we want. Like you said, Saros or, you know, a draft pick yeah. or whatever it's going to be. But I think, you know, we've tried to speculate last year and this year on who might want a goalie, and Nashville seems like, based on what we're seeing there, I mean, you know, Pekka Rene's not having a great year. That seems like a team that might be willing to pay for one of our two goalies.
And if they're willing to pay a decent price tag for him, why not? Like, especially with Hiller, since he's took that month off, he's played a lot better in each of his games. And like against Vancouver, he was a really good goaltender in that game. So if he continues to have like a good effort, like I know he's playing tomorrow against Toronto, if he can keep the ball rolling, that will help increase his value.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's going to look at him as a starter going in the playoffs right now, but it might be the, okay, we just need some veteran help as the backup going into the playoffs, and this guy's playing well enough. Let's go out and move to get mm-hmm. him.
Because he can play the Kujel role that one year that him backing up Kipper and against San Jose, and he came in played well when needed in the playoffs. So could be that kind of a guy.
There might be hope for Hiller and his contract after
all.
That's one contract I'd be really surprised but really happy if we could move, is Hiller's contract.
Well, at the deadline, you're talking only like adding $2 million or something like that to the cap. So,
well, I guess it's more just getting something for it. Like, you know, he's had a terrible year. If we can turn a terrible year into something good, that would be fantastic.
True enough.
It's not so much the money. It's just the, you know, he was overpaid. He didn't live up to his contract. If we can at least make something out of it, especially if we can get a longer-term piece, that'd be fantastic.
Can't argue with that.
Matt, why don't we spend some time since the beginning of February taking a look at some of the Flames' prospects and how they're doing so far? Rasmus Anderson was the Flames' second-round pick in 2015, and he's had a good week for the Barrie Colts. He notched 2 assists in 2 games last week. Right now, he's played 47 games for Barrie. He has 7 goals and 40 assists. That's 47 points so far, and he's a plus 22.
Yeah, if I recall, he's one of the top scorers in the all of Canada, so for defensemen,
yeah,
so that's always good to see. Offensive stats in the CHL is always a questionable metric to rate players by, but anytime a guy is putting up numbers, that's never a bad thing, and him being one of the top scorers, that hopefully will translate once he moves to Stockton.
And his teammate, who also plays in Barrie, is the Flames' sixth-round pick, who you and I have talked about from 2015. We've talked about him quite a bit. That's Andrew Mangiapane. And he was a guy that nobody knew a lot about. We really liked him at training camp. And so far, he's registered 4 goals in 2 games last week, sits second on his team with 65 points in the year. And this is a guy who was picked up in the sixth round. So he's played 41 games, 34 goals, 31 assists for 65 total points, and he's a plus 20. From a sixth, you're right about CHL scoring, but from a guy who's picked up in the sixth round to be second in team scoring on a decent Barrie team this year, that's impressive. This might be one of those sleeper prospects for the Flames who, you know, was drafted in the sixth round and ends up being I wouldn't say a star NHL player, but I think this guy might have a future as a professional player.
Could very well be. And with him coming out of nowhere when in his first crack at the draft and posting a pretty good season and then repeating it last year, maybe he's just one of those players that didn't peak until he was a teenager and can carry on. Who knows? We'll see, and at least he's showing that he's growing as an offensive threat, and if he was to take a step back this season and like only have, like, say, 30 points at this point, then his long-term viability as a player would be more in doubt, but at least at this point he's doing everything that he needs to. And next season and beyond, there will be new goals that he has to set.
I got the chance to watch some Hitman hockey this week. I'm continually impressed by Pavel Kharnikov. He was the fifth-round pick in 2015. He's not having a really stellar year. He's only got 24 points in 35 games and was pointless in the last three. But he's a pretty solid WHL player. And again, a guy I think will be around here for a while. And his teammate, who's actually, I think, has had a good year since he got re-sent down to the WHL, was Keegan Kanzig. Kanzig looked a bit lost in his few games in the AHL this year, but the WHL seems to be more of his speed, and unfortunately, I think because of that, there's a guy who doesn't have a lot of future with the Flames.
Well, in the past with Kanzig, we had mentioned that his skating had improved at the development camp and that. And now that's not really a problem that's going to hamper him. Now he needs to figure out how to pass the puck effectively, how to shoot the puck effectively, and learn all the other aspects of the game that he will need in order to take those next steps. And
I think the Kanzig's always got by kind of being the big, mean guy, and we're seeing a lot of that role being phased out of the NHL. So, yeah, I think you're right. He needs to kind of reinvent himself and figure out who he's going to be from here on in.
And realistically, Kanzig, when we drafted him, that's not a player that's going to be in the NHL in two or three seasons. He's probably, if he does make the NHL, he'll be 24 or 25 when he gets there. And it, because of the fact that he needed to work on so many things in order to get to that next level. If he can round out his game, his offensive numbers are pretty good this season for him. If he can round things out and improve his overall game, there still is potential for him to become an NHL player. There's just a lot of work that he will need to do to get from where he is now till then.
I personally think Kanzig is going to be a guy we're going to see float around the Flames minor league for 4 or 5 years and then just kind of get cast away.
And if you're a betting person, that's the likeliest of scenarios, but there still is upside. And anytime you have a 6'7" player, they'll be given every shot possible to figure things out.
Moving to the U.S. leagues, if we take a ride down to Providence and Providence College, where the Flames have a couple guys playing, John Gilmore didn't play this week on defense. He was out for a shoulder injury. He's in his senior season with Providence, so his last year there, and he's played 25 games. He has 18 points. I got to see some Providence hockey this week online. From a couple weeks ago. It wasn't a game this week, but it was delayed a couple weeks. I actually think that Gilmore's coming along. He's been a guy that we've seen a little bit around here at prospect camps, and he's never looked spectacular, but he's looking good for Providence this year.
And we'll see. I don't know yet if the Flames will sign him. It depends largely on what they do with the farm system, and
I think he'll end up getting an AHL deal, personally.
Yeah, it largely, I think, depends on if the Flames are able to move out Russell and or one of Smead or England. The Flames have a lot of players in Stockton on defense, and I don't know if there's enough room for a guy like Gilmore. It could be. It depends. You also have to figure that the Flames have Adam Ollis-Matson and Russian Rafikov, and they both might be coming over next season. So
Ollis-Matson's hurt right now. He suffered a lower body fracture at the World Juniors, and he's still out with that injury. So I don't know if he'd be ready to go next year. I think he's going to have a bit of a setback, and I can see them sending him back for another year if it sets him back too much.
Lots of variables.
The other guy in Providence who I think has come along, we saw him at the rookie camp this year and thought that he's really come along too, is the gamble that the Flames made a couple years ago. The 21st overall pick in 2012, which is Mark Jankowski, and he's tied for Providence's team scoring lead with 28 goals in 28 games, or 28 points in 28 games. He has 12 goals and 16 assists. I liked what we saw of him this past summer. I thought last summer he was almost invisible. He was hurt, but when we'd seen him in, seasons past and then the regular camp, he was almost invisible every other time we'd seen him. But this past summer, Jankowski finally looks like he's turned a corner.
Yeah, and at least with his points in Stockton, in Providence, it's going up each season. He's elevating his game year by year, and that's what you're hoping for developmentally, is that he's not stagnating at any point, and his overall game has improved. If the Flames do sign him, which I fully anticipate they will, I could even see him possibly stealing a spot out of training camp next year, but that will depend on how the summer goes for him.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd put him that high, at least on my depth chart, where he's going to steal a spot. I think there's a lot of guys the AHL level.
Oh, for sure.
He
could, though, is what I'm getting at. Like, he might be able to.
But, you know, I think he'll definitely be a guy who, if the Flames sign him, will want to turn him pro. I don't know if he's in his last year of college, this year or next year.
He is.
So turn him pro right away. And I can see him doing fairly well at the AHL level. But, I mean, he was sort of a weird pick when the Flames made the pick. And I think that he's going to need, personally, a couple seasons of seasoning. Not only because of where he's at in his game, but just because of the depth chart. I think he's going to be in the AHL for a couple of years while other guys who've earned a shot first probably get those shots.
Could very well be. His destiny will be up to him. And I think if he plays as good as he did in the prospect camp and brings that level of game into the training camp, I think he may just steal a spot. I think at first the Flames may try him as a winger, but we'll see.
Maybe he'll be the next line mate for Mason Raymond in Stockton.
Who knows? Lots of hockey to be played before we figure out all these things.
And back in November, Trilevine talked to Primetime Sports in the Sportsnet family, and he said that he had every intention of signing Jankowski, which I'm not surprised. I mean, he's a first-round pick. You want to give the guy a shot.
Well, 6 foot four.
I don't see any reason not to give him a shot.
6 foot four centers don't grow on trees, and especially ones that have offensive and defensive ability. You need guys like that. And even if Jankowski only becomes a quality third-line center, that is a successful late first-round pick. Like a guy like Michael Backlund was a late first-round pick, and he's developed into a quality third-line guy.
And it's taken him some time, but I think we're starting to see. Him finally coming around.
And you got to remember, Jankowski's only 1 month older than Sean Monahan, so it's not like he's an older guy, even though he's a senior in college. So we'll see.
Well, Matt, anything else you want to talk about before we get to our predictions?
No, just hoping that the Flames have a good week ahead and maybe make this remaining 31 games of the season more interesting instead of counting down the days for the end of the year.
Well, let's look ahead to this week, and before we do, let's remind everyone that our weekly predictions are brought to you by TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their mobile phone. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off when buying tickets. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. Download the TickTix app today in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. And there's quite a few home games actually coming up this month. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 left this month. And there's a whole 2-week stretch in March. So if you haven't made it down to the Dome yet to see a Flames game, definitely do that. I think as we get near the end of February and into early March, you're going to be seeing a very different roster on the ice for this team. So definitely get down there. It's always fun to go to a game. And if you don't know what to do for Family Day this coming Monday, remember there's a 2 p.m. matinee game. Not so good if you want a good score, because we don't generally do well with those, but it'll probably be a fun family game. The Flames usually do a Family Day pretty good. So, Matt, looking ahead at this week then, the Flames have 4 games, 8 points on the table. Tuesday night, we're host to the Toronto Maple Leafs. Then we go on the road and play back-to-back Thursday, Friday against San Jose and the Arizona Coyotes, and then we come back here on Monday for Family Day to play against the Ducks. 8 points, 4 games. Last week, neither of us won. I predicted 0 points, and you predicted 2 points. You thought we'd get a win against Columbus? We did, but we also... Or, sorry, that was the one game we lost. You predicted the one we didn't
win. So I got everything exactly wrong.
You did. What do you think for this week?
I'm going to go a little unorthodox and say 8 full points.
Wow.
I think that the team, especially after what happened today, I think that they're going to be pissed at themselves for the lack of effort at the practice and will respond by massacring Toronto. And realistically, they need to win every Pacific Division game, so I'll go with the full 8.
Well, and if you listen to some of the players and even the coach talking, they're pretty much saying that every game from here on in is a must win. And I think that's the attitude they're trying to instill in their own dressing room. I agree with you that I think after the practice today, they're going to be pissed at themselves. I can see them coming out and beating Toronto. I don't know if they're going to win both games in the back-to-back, though. So I'm going to say the Flames beat Toronto. I think the Flames are going to beat... I'm trying to think which of the two back-to-backs. I think they'll ride the high from Toronto and beat the Sharks. We've struggled a lot against Phoenix this year, and I think they'll beat the Ducks. So I'm going to go 6 points.
Wow, both of us are optimistic. That's a shocker.
Yeah.
After weeks on end of us picking like 2 and 4 points or zero.
Well, that's it. I mean, you've picked 0, 1, 2, 3 times this year. I've picked it once. We've had a terrible season as far as actually predicting things. One of us always seems to be too optimistic, and one of us seems to be too much of a downer. So this year, this week, we're both optimistic. I can't see us winning both back-to-backs.
Yeah, watch us get 0 points just to mess with.
Oh, probably. No, knowing how this team's played all year, it's 2 and 5. You're beating me in the game. But, I mean, we've both had terrible scores so far. It'll probably be, unfortunately, a big goose egg.
Or something like that. Like, we might get 2 points or something just to be contrary to our optimism.
Watch, we'll probably get 2 overtime losses.
Yeah, why not?
2 1-point games or 4 1-point games. Who knows? But, yeah, no, I don't know. I'm optimistic. I think after the practice today and the Mason Raymond, AHL, I don't know what you – it's not a recall if you're sent down. Demotion, yeah. I guess. The AHL demotion, I think that this team means business. And I think the players are starting to feel it and the coach is starting to feel it. And, you know, as we look at this week – I think we've really only got this week and next week left until we start to see this team being reshaped. I think it's going to be about the 20th to the 22nd we start seeing guys moved out of here.
Yeah.
So.
And realistically, if you look at the 31 games, San Jose, if they continue at their pace, they're going to get 95 points. In order for the Flames to do that, they're going to have to win like 22 of the 31 games.
It's not happening.
It could, but they'd have to win a lot between now and then. And
you'd have to have another January for the rest of the season.
Yeah, well.
Or December,
yeah,
I mean.
They'd need to pretty much win like 7 games in a row starting tonight and then play well beyond that. So, we'll see. Anything's possible. If the Flames actually play like they can, it is possible. But we've been harping on consistency all season. So if they figure out how to play consistently each game, it'll make things interesting. If they don't, then we'll be looking ahead to whom we're picking in the draft.
I also think that if we see the same kind of efforts, and especially a practice this week, from the Flames that we've seen last week, I can see the coaching staff really coming down on this team.
Oh, for sure. Because that's not acceptable.
No, and I mean, Hartley's already walked out on a practice. I can see them starting to recall AHL bodies and just saying, okay, you guys don't want to play? Fine, don't play.
Yeah.
Scratching 5 or 6 guys and bringing in some AHL bodies. So I really think we're at the point where Hartley's had enough of this. And, I think he's maybe humored them a little bit, but I really think that right now, this next week is going to be put up or shut up for the Flames. We're going to really see what this team's attitude is. Do they want to play hockey? Do they want to play at a high level or not?
Yeah. And I think, honestly, the game tomorrow, unless the Flames win, say 6-1 or some similar blowout, I think that the team as a whole, I think that will be like the final verdict on this team. And
yeah, I think definitely a 6-1 win, but I think it depends how they play too. I mean, we got a 4-1 win not playing a great game over Vancouver. I think they have to play 60 minutes and get a really high score if you want to prove that you can do this.
Mm-hmm.
But we'll see. I mean, you can tell that there's some unhappiness with the players. You can tell there's some unhappiness with management. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Bouma sitting. But just because I think that there might be some hard feelings there. But I think it could be good. I think this might be the jolt this team needs, not to necessarily make the playoffs. I'm kind of writing them off for this year, but to, you know, finish the season strong. And more for us as fans, it's to showcase the pieces we want to move out of here.
Mm-hmm. Lots of fun in Flames Nation, that's for sure.
So, yeah, the Sea of Red has very been polarized this past month. Some people still think that we've got hope for the playoffs. Some people think that we don't have any hope, that, you know, we're looking ahead to the draft. I think realistically, looking ahead to the draft is probably the right thing to do if you're a fan. If you're the players, you can't be giving up and making your tee times yet.
No.
You still got to finish out 30 games, boys.
Yeah. Well, we'll see.
And let's see if we can get at least 6 points this week, Matt.
Yeah. It'll be interesting.
I'm really looking forward to the Toronto game tomorrow.
Same here.
What do you think of the new Toronto logo that was unveiled?
I think it's a good one. Big step in the right direction. They were only successful when they had a variation of that logo. So, like, they unveiled their current logo back in 67-68. So, ever since then, they've been terrible. So, might as well go.
And we think the Oilers have been terrible for a while. You know, I think the fact that we're seeing Toronto unveil a new logo, and we've heard that, you know, Florida's going to have a new logo, the more we see these logos queuing up, the more it leads me to still believe that we're seeing a whole new set of jerseys next year. Generally, logos change when jerseys change.
I agree. And I think that will be a welcome change for the Flames as well.
Well, it depends. I mean, before the RBK jerseys came in, we heard rumors that they want to do something different. They want to try the vertical striping, and that was the big rumor. And we really haven't heard anything about Adidas. And Adidas is still owned by Reebok, so they'll probably, I imagine, use the same edge cut for the jersey, like the same style of jersey. But with Toronto going back more to a throwback logo, and, you know, there's been some call for a throwback type jersey in Calgary, I wouldn't be surprised if we see much more traditional-looking jerseys in the next round for all 30 teams.
Well, change is always interesting, if not good in some cases. So,
like, I think we'll see a lot more horizontal striping. I think we'll see a lot more, you know, traditional color schemes.
Yeah, or even experimentation, sort of like the Colorado third jersey. Or even Phoenix's jerseys for this season. Just something different.
Maybe somebody will put a pedestal on their jersey again. Like the Flames mid-90s jerseys.
Well, are any of the teams owned by Air Canada? Or Canadian Airlines
Canadian Airlines
it was?
Isn't even around anymore.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Yeah, who knows? But I don't know. I just have a sense. I mean, it's hot in design trends right now, too. Sort of the retro, the old school, you know, look. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see a lot of teams sort of rolling back the clock and going with a more traditional look to the jersey.
Time will tell.
Yeah, but no, I'm pretty sure we're getting a new uniform here in Calgary next year, which could be a welcome change or not, depending on what they do. I just hope whatever they do, they get rid of the stupid numbers for the third jersey. Those better not get taken over. Have a proper five at the very least. Let's flip the two upside down. I sound like an old man.
Yeah.
Get off my five.
On that cheery note, have a good one.
You too, Matt. We'll talk to you next week after the Flames play the Ducks in their matinee.
Yeah. All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. Have a good week.
Talk to you later, man. Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.